I saw the live thing on.
Okay, welcome. We are live. So joining me today is a guest, a very special guest, Hakuan Lau, coming all the way from Poland.
Krakow, yes.
Krakow. So for those who don't know you, would you say something briefly about your who you are, your background, and so forth?
I used to be Rich's guitarist. Yeah. He had a band, and I was a hired gun that played for him. We did some gigs, and but my musicianship does not pay the bills enough. And sometimes I do teach a class or two on the side on neuroscience to mix ends meet.
A class or two on the side.
And I also, out of hobby, I also run a lab or two, doing neuroscience experiments.
At UCLA and also at the University of Hong Kong. Do you run a lab there, or is this at the Donders Institute?
I have two students there. Yeah.
Okay.
So I have a small lab, a smaller team in Hong Kong, and a full team at UCLA at this point.
Okay, very cool. And so it's very good to have you here talking. This is live, so remember things that you say might be seen by actual persons.
Yeah, would there be beep sounds if I used some inappropriate words? Or
fuck no.
Oh, no. But it's like gloves off. Anything is okay. Okay.
Within limits, yes, anything is.
I have to give a disclaimer from the outset. I really am very sleep deprived. You know, ASSC is like, as I mentioned in my blog to In Consciousness We Trust, which is my blog. I said ASSC is like Christmas. You know, you see families, hang out all night and go to talks all day. And so it's a very, you know, neurochemically modulated existence. Your coffee, caffeine by day, alcohol by night. So I'm very sleep deprived. Sorry if I said something inappropriate. I apologize profusely to the people who might be offended in advance.
Duly noted. It's funny because I remember as a graduate student, my first conference that I ever went to was with a psychology lab that I was working at SF State, and the PI of that was an ERP guy, family-related potential guy. And so I worked with undergraduates doing that sort of stuff. And my thing I liked was visual illusions. But anyway, his point was at the conference, which this conference was at the Society for Psychophysiological Research, the SPR.
Yeah. Yeah.
And he said, I'm gonna teach you how to be a psychologist. And he said, here's how you do it. You have to drink all night and still get up and go to the talks at 8 a.m.
I used to do that, you know, when I was younger, but now I don't do this for all conferences anymore. For most conferences, I would skip like one third of the stuff or sometimes even half of it, depending on how much I'm interested. So I take a lot of breaks during the day, and I would maybe have dinner with people, but maybe I'll drink the last night, go out drinking last night. But ASSC is really very intense. It's a group of fairly, you know, somewhat, I mean, quote and unquote, the word can be misinterpreted, but kind of incestuous, very closely knitted friends who grew up together as adults. I mean, these people I've known, many of them, my whole adult life, and we were stuck from starry-eyed students to now, you know, full professors, and we really grew up together, seeing each other every year, arguing, resuming arguments after exactly 1 year's time. And every year you go home and think, okay, this year I'll go collect the data. So next June I'll come back and convince you again. And so that relationship developed over a decade and a half is pretty intense.
Yeah, no, I agree. The ASSC is a very close-knit community. It's very, you know, I've been to the conference only 6 times. I mean, I guess this is its, can't be its 22nd meeting.
It is the 22nd meeting.
Yeah, so I've only been to 6 out of the 22. How many have you been to?
I've been to, I think, more than half of it, or at least half of it the past 17 years.
Wow. So how have you seen a change over those 17 years, like from the beginning till now? Have you seen like a difference in the quality of the meeting, who comes to it, that sort of thing?
Yeah, I think there's a general, I mean, there's a pretty steady improvement in the quality, the rigor of the science has definitely improved, and I think it reached a point, I think in Paris, that was 3 years ago. So usually the European meetings are the bigger, more important, because most of the good neuroscience labs or the empirical, the labs in consciousness are in Europe, the good ones anyway.
That's because there's funding there.
yeah, we can talk a bit about structural problems, but funding and other issues. In the US, it's not like there are no people doing it, but the people doing it do not necessarily identify themselves as consciousness researchers, or they might do empirical work, but are not so invested in the theories. Whereas in Europe, you have labs that are basically doing empirical work in order to test theories or to build theories. Mm. And so the European meeting tends to be the most important. So the one in Paris 3 years ago, I think reached a point, is basically just like any other cognitive neuroscience conference. And some really good stuff you see there first at SSC before I see it in any other kind of conference. So this year has been kind of a continuation of that in that trajectory. Despite the fact that I feel in the US we are doing rather poorly in the past few years. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things I think that I think is really admirable about you is that you're a person who came to the US, set up a lab that was interested in doing empirical work, testing theories of consciousness, and you didn't try to hide it. You sort of made no bones about it, that's what you're interested in. And I think that's a very difficult thing to do in the US, the way the funding system is set up.
Yeah. Not sure it's admirable or just foolhardy and stupid.
Sometimes it's hard to tell the difference.
I started out young, right? You know, when I first met you in New York, I was like 27, 28. I just was too foolish and thought I was just to do whatever I wanted. And in a way, it was dicey. But I mean, somehow I survived.
I think you might be one of the only people that I know of who got tenure doing this kind of work in the US. Can you think of anyone else off the top of your head?
Yeah, this level of engagement with the theory. So a lot of people do great empirical work in consciousness. Don't get me wrong, like Marvin Chern, Frank Tong, you know, Louis Pessoa, just to name a few, Tony Rowe, many people do it. But I think to do it and also be involved in theory at this level, there are some Ezequiel Mosello at UC San Francisco. I'll consider him also very invested in theory. Yeah, but in a so-called major research university, whatever that means, meaning that they give you a big paycheck, a big startup to start your lab. And you have to, you're expected to bring in nationally funded grants in order to get tenure, that sort of system, then I think is actually, yeah, rather crucial.
Yeah, and I know that people warned you against that sort of stuff when you were starting out. I know that you were warned by people and you know, like you said, it was a pretty dicey move, but it paid off for you. And I think you're setting a great example for our next generation.
I survived. Personally, it was a cost. Like, it was not like I gambled and won big. I gambled and it didn't die. That was
and that's something. He lived to tell the tale. That's great.
Yeah. Not dying is good.
Not dying is good.
Yep.
Okay. So how important do you think, since you mentioned theory, how important do you think theory is to studying consciousness?
I used to be more positive, more excited about it. Now I'm getting more neutral. I feel theories, at this point, I'm actually rather down about it because I see the danger as well, right? So I've seen how some other camps have let the theory run wild and really poisoned the whole thing. I've seen how research programs were basically destroyed by how the proponents get so hung up about the theory and get so become like almost like a cult, yeah. Almost like a religious thing. And if people disagree with them, they don't talk to them anymore. They fudge the data and stuff like that. So I used to be, you know, I come with a background in philosophy. That's where, you know, we hang out and stuff. But at this point, I think theories are good. They're interesting. They're also dangerous business. I can see why my colleagues really warned me against it at this point. Now that in hindsight, I see like, because such a dangerous thing, I see like really very smart people, very, very established people. Basically, I feel completely tarnished their reputation and
because of maybe a commitment to theory over data. Is that the problem?
Yeah, basically, yeah.
So when the theory is driving the data as opposed to the data driving the theory, then you get a real problem.
Yeah, that's definitely, yeah, that's just,
yeah. And you know, I mean because part of the reason I want to talk to you is because of this recent article which came out about the Tucson conferences, which quoted ordered some stuff from you. And I know you were involved. I mean, that's where we first met at Tucson. You were the chair of the session that I gave my first talk at there. And I remember you gave me a good compliment. You said, what you said was pretty sensible for a philosopher to say.
Pretty good.
And that was the beginning of a lasting friendship. but I know, so you've been involved. You're one of these people who's been involved in both conferences. And in the Tucson conferences, you've been an organizer, right, on the scientific program committee, I think, at various points. Yep. You've grown somewhat disillusioned with it, at least judging from your comments that you've made in this article. And so I wonder if you could just say something about that. So the difference between the ASCC and the Tucson conferences in your mind.
Yeah, so Tucson, I was on the program committee, but really there wasn't much program committee work to be done because really we have no voting power. So the conference is run by one person, Professor Stuart Hemroff, who's an anesthesiologist, and he's a doctor. He has his own views about quantum theories of consciousness, and it's all good. But this, when it's run by one person, it's really, I liken it to a music festival, right? Because it's not really a run by a professional society. That basically, the kind of peer review is not what you expect of an academic conference. Usually, we have voted program committee members, and the program committee members vote on what goes to the program. That's the normal mechanism of a peer reviewed and professional academic meeting, and that just isn't like that. I think maybe it's all right. I mean, it's just not. I wouldn't call it a professional meeting.
Yeah, so, I agree. I think that's an important criticism because even I mean, I think what you said.
It's just what it is. It's just not an academic meeting. So if you don't expect it to be an academic meeting, if you expect it to be a music festival, it's like Burning Man. There's some talks in Burning Man. So I mean, there's some festival with some academics go and give talks, and there's also music. There's also social, and like that, it is what it is.
I mean, I've been to lots of conferences where there's music as well as presentations. And so, I don't know if that disqualifies it. But, I mean, I can tell you, that when I first was, as a graduate student, I got accepted to present there. I thought that was a serious achievement because I submitted something and then it was accepted. And I was like, well, this is someone, I thought that it's not clear to the people who are being involved on the other side that that's the way things are. It's not clear that there isn't a program committee, that there isn't voting, that there isn't a kind of rigorous thing going on there. And so there is when I found out of all of this stuff, I did feel a bit let down, a bit like, well, what they're just accepting as many things as they can to fill up as many spots as they can. So they bring in and they're charging $450 for the registration fee. So
And a lot of people go there, don't present. They're just interested in, seeing some sort of certain celebrities in action.
Yeah.
So, it is not very good. I think.
Yeah, it's really too bad because I think that a lot of people, that's their first exposure to consciousness.
This is a serious issue, and I'm also on the board of ASCC, and I just brought up this issue today at lunch at the board meeting.
Response? Can you share? What was the response of the board, or can you not share?
I shouldn't tell you. I can tell you what I say. I shouldn't tell you what other people say. I think it's a serious issue because many people don't even know that there is a professional society-run meeting on consciousness. So ASCC, I think, does not promote itself aggressively enough, or maybe arguably doesn't have the same kind of budget or machinery to do this, but I think we have to push harder now. I think especially, so the last few years, some people argue, I've always felt this way about Tucson, and it got them a bit worse, especially they've invited people who are basically not legitimate. They're not even, maybe the word legitimate is not necessary. They're just not even academics. They just invited lifestyle gurus to give talks. And so that has soured things a lot for other people.
Yeah, I think the Deepak Chopra, I know that's who you mean. I mean, I'm not against idealism per se. I don't really take that view to be in the realm of scientifically testable, that's not what I have against him. I think his view of selling quantum medicine, and I think Deepak qualifies as a charlatan. in the real sense of that word.
I have no particular qualms about him, but I think his being there really brought out the whole problem that why is he there? Well, because there is no program committee. So if Steele likes him, then he's there. That is the problem. So it's basically not that there's no voting mechanism. There's no, it's not a representative peer review system. It's just one guy's who he likes.
Yeah. And it's the Center for Consciousness Study is basically him and Abby, and that's it, right? I don't think there's a really.
I believe so. You can check their website. Yeah. Dave Chalmers used to be more directly involved, and Uriah Kriegel too, but Uriah Kriegel left and Dave Chalmers left. I think Dave still could have been there, and it probably does, but I don't know, you know.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Important point that the ASC is a professional society, and it runs this meeting. And even if it's even if it's a bit incestuous, like everyone knows everyone, and so the people on the committees are probably know people who they're judging. Even that's still better than just having a kind of de facto dictatorship of one person making all these decisions.
I don't think the incestuous nature was a bad thing. It just is a small field. And because of the failure of the field to break into America, so it remained small, and it remained small. Then, and also the people are very passionate about this sort of stuff. So people usually study this stuff. Really, it takes over their life. I mean, it's really consciousness studies. It's science. Is my life. You know. So I think many people take it the same way. So that's why it's so closely connected to people. It's not a bad thing. I mean. Any society, any academic society has this kind of club culture. You may not think it's a good thing, but it's just the way it is. Same for society for neuroscience, any of this. If you think that people in the executive board and all these people don't know each other, I mean, the more well known you are in the field, you climb up the ladder, you know each other better. There's always this kind of club culture.
So that's one question I have for you is, what do you think the people who study attention did that broke them into the mainstream? Because attention didn't used to be what it is now, and now it's considered just like another area. And the rise of the people who study attention is kind of an interesting comparison, I think, to what's happening with consciousness studies. So, what do you think? If you agree with me, I don't know. I think you do. I'm not sure.
I have a. If you do a Google, what's called n-gram, or what's that? You search the frequency of words in books. I once searched it. It's like very clear that they used to be similar. You should be sort of visual attention and visual awareness. You can see that the attention at some point pulled away from us. Yeah.
So, what do you think the people who are working in that area? I mean, if you have any comments, what do you think they did, which set them on that trajectory and might offer people in our area a kind of guiding stone or something?
Yeah, I think it's really two explosions. The first one probably is Broad Bend. So it's really the idea that they took some ideas from cognitive science. So Donald Broad Bend, of course, is one of the founding fathers of cognitive science, and all those like box and arrow diagrams, all this stuff is, I think, a lot. He's one of the pioneers for that. The idea is to take some simple analogy from computer science or signal processing. And so he brought Ben, of course, study like radar operators and how they do tasks and stuff. So he had the attention filter theories, basically from all these like signal and channels and gating and stuff. So take some simple concepts and don't go too crazy with the math. Just do some experiments and be empirical, have some concepts that are simple and clear. And that exploded. And then, of course, Broadband trained Traceman, and then Traceman took the theory a bit further. Again, none of this was very technical, just simple ideas, do the experiment right, you know, control your confounds, eat your vegetables, that kind of approach, and just like do it right. And that exploded again, some good ideas. And then Lili LaVie took it a bit further, and it went further. And then I think in the 90s, what really happened too was after a few decades of this continuous growth from in psychology, then in cognitive psychology, the electrophysiologists start to get interested. So I mean, on top of it, especially the neurophysiologists, the animal models, the single neuron guys got interested, and that just exploded. Then it took over, you know, the whole field of neuroscience, because people realized you can study this kind of really high level cool stuff at the single neuron circuit level. Then it just exploded.
So what role do you think operational definitions played in that? Any, do you think that was important that they were able to operationalize?
Yeah, totally, totally. Yeah, they did. They weren't so hung up about these, really conceptual problems or trying to write down the math for attention. Nobody tried to do anything silly like that. They just went, okay, let's define two kinds of attention. One is, exogenous. One is endogenous. So that is you either move your eyes or you move your mind's eye. Or you get cued externally by some stimulus, or you try to listen to an instruction. Sorry, I just screwed up textbook for first year.
He's sleep deprived, folks.
When you move your eyes or not move your eyes, that's called covert versus overt attention. And the other one is whether you're cued by an external stimulus or follow an instruction and try to direct your attention to certain things. That's endogenous versus exogenous. So just simple dichotomies that are not necessarily very profound or very clean, but they just define it. And then they have some simple tasks like the postnatal curing tasks and stuff. And then your tracement, your conjunction search versus single feature search. Very simple, almost like very forced dichotomy. And it just worked. And it held a few together, people organized, and tracement also have some very simple theories. You know, they're not like mathematically detailed, they're just like a kind of box and arrow kind of theory. And that's all there is.
So there's a lot that I want to ask you about in what you just said right there. But one of the things that I'm picking up on is the boxology and versus math. So I wonder if what's behind that comment is something about where the right level to pitch a theory of consciousness is. Okay. So it sounds like boxology is supposed to be at the psychological level, at the algorithmic level, maybe not at the level of implementation, which maybe would be at the level of neuroscience if you want to take a very simplistic view. So is that something like what you were saying, that what we want to do is start with psychological theories as opposed to neuroscientific theories?
It's that simple, right? It's that simple, get more data. So your theory to data ratio should never be too high, basically. Yeah, you should just keep healthy. You don't have a lot of data, you don't theorize to the moon. And you just keep something simple and then you build the data. At least you arbitrate some simple hypotheses first. And then at some point in the 90s, people do start to write equation, but they're like very simple, like bias competition. It's like just a couple of, linear equations, basically. It's not like nothing really fancy, and that's
so you don't expect some complicated mathematical formalism to end up being true about consciousness?
They're totally hopeless.
So that's like IIT, obviously. That's, I think, the main candidate for a mathematical theory of consciousness. That's a problem.
That's probably one of the most clear case of failure in the field.
Interesting.
Also, we're over promoted, and I think it's also almost I think, let me put it even stronger still, because I'm already sleep deprived, I gave my disclaimer. But actually, I would say I think it's a liability to the field at this point, IIT, a very major liability to the entire field.
Really? Because so, why do you think so many people are excited about it? I mean, not just as neuroscientists, but there seems to be a kind of general excitement about IIT.
I think there are two factors. One is just unfortunate, but I think many people mistaken. I think it's come from I think both are unfortunate. So the first one is that in the 90s, when people claimed that consciousness research really happened. Are you drinking scotch?
It's rye whiskey.
Oh, damn, I wish I had a drink. But anyway,
make you one and pass it over.
In the 90s, when they pretended that the consciousness research just happened right there, it's historically just false.
Yeah,
it's a revised history. Unfortunately, because when you go back before the 90s, it's very hard. Papers are not in PubMed, so a lot of people are too lazy to dig up the literature. But it's very obvious that, of course. I mean, it's just blatantly false. So even the people, it's not like hidden literature. The thing that people talk about, like blindsight, Libet experiments, split brain, all of this stuff, of course, way before the 90s.
Yeah.
Where the bar spoke to all of that before 90s. But somehow there's a lie that goes around, say, oh, it all started in the 90s. And what really happened in the 90s, the physicists jumped in and really stole the show. And there is a sense that they push for a very physics-oriented approach to studying consciousness, which is like from the armchair, from some math, and then the universe is causally closer without consciousness. You don't fully understand our place in nature. What is very high sounding thing, almost as if people are trying to get a second Nobel Prize, this sort of stuff. That really got a lot of physicists and people who think that it's more like a physics problem than a biomedical science problem. And that is bad because at the end of the day, it is about the brain and stuff. I mean, at least most of the studies are about the brain. If you want to study consciousness in trees, you go ahead. I mean, I don't want to hang out with you in the same conference anyway. But if you want to study consciousness in brains, then you need to study brains, and you need to study brains using the methods of studying brains, which is like neuroscience and all this stuff. And then the physics approach really just radically don't work, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we don't have the foundation of Newtonian physics, which is very empirically rigorous and robust, that are called laws. We don't have laws in neuroscience. I mean, there might be some, but nothing at the level you hope you get. So really, it's really a slow accumulation of evidence kind of thing. So IIT has a flavor that appeals to some people who have this kind of physics oriented approach. I think that's one reason there's some excitement, but there's a small reason. I think the bigger reason is just because my you know, good colleague and friend and mentor, Christoph Koch, I think he just over-promoted the theory. And I think I have to say, I'm sorry to say, it's just foul play. He just go around saying that this is the best theory, it is the most promising theory. I'm not making it up, but you can find it in quotes and in popular articles everywhere. And I think that's just wrong. We know that it's wrong. Actually, if you go to ASCC, it's like one of the least accepted theory. Actually, one of the most disliked theory, I would say, because it's been so over-promoted and yet it's so poor.
Right. Yeah, I definitely agree that he has an enormous influence on the field, and he's using it to promote a certain theory. And in fact, it's kind of underhanded. He's basically setting it up so that there's only two dominant players, IIT and global workspace theory. And
it's just a false picture. I mean, to me, that's even worse than I talk about the 90s revising history. This is even worse than that. It's revising current, basically misrepresenting the field to the degree that basically, I think, undercuts the progress of the field.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a real issue. I mean, I've actually been pressured by editors to address IIT when I was writing things that have nothing to do with it. So you get comments back and say, why isn't IIT addressed in here? Information integrated theory, like where is it? Like, well, it's not really relevant, but
I think at this point, it would be fair to say you don't consider it a scientifically, it's basically not a scientific theory. So I think I also don't, it's like if someone asks you to comment on Freud, you can refuse that.
So this is the empirical testability issue. Is that what you're talking about? Why it's not a scientific theory?
It's not really testable in foreseeable future. And yeah, so it's basically, I mean, not science.
In principle, maybe you could compute phi for the brain, but in practice it's impossible. And they have various ways of estimating it, I guess, but it doesn't seem like that's good enough.
Yeah. So actually, one of the great things today we learned in today, Adam Barrett's talk. He's from Sussex, and he gave a very good review of the different approximations. So this is one thing about physics approach again, right? So if you have a theory that is in principle computable, that's not useful for biomedical science. We want to do it right now, right? You want to solve cancer, you don't want to have a complete theory of cancer, but you cannot compute it. There are patients dying right now, it's not funny. You have to do something right now. So the biomedical approach has always been very close to the bench and try to get data. So a theory that cannot actually be computed is basically worthless. So they would say, oh, but they're approximations. But turns out that there are many different variants of approximations you can do, and they give very different results, radically different. So then I pointed out today to Adam and said, so basically this means the theory is not testable. He said, why? Well, he didn't say why. I basically, if the reason is if you have these different measures and they don't conform to each other, then you're basically asking for trouble. Scientists with fudge data. I mean, when I get some, you choose whichever you want you like to fit the data. So you'll never be falsified. Basically, since you have this like wide selection of measures you can choose, you will never lose. If you never lose, you also never win.
Yeah. And that, I mean, so falsifiability is obviously important for science. I tend to be someone who thinks that maybe things like string theory put pressure on falsifiability as a benchmark for a theory being scientific, and there may be other constraints which are important. But I think with this, your point about the biomedical issues kind of moots that point.
Exactly.
That makes it much more important and close to home. But also, I would say, I think all these problems are really deep problems. So the Scott Aronson problem of the high five for this ridiculous thing written on a piece of paper, incomputability in practice. But I also think there's a deeper kind of fundamental philosophical problem about IIT, which is that it starts from axioms, which are supposed to be known introspectively. And, like, for instance, that consciousness is unified. That's an axiom. Okay. Well, lots of people deny that, actually. Yeah. So it smuggles in already a loaded conception of the thing it's trying to explain. That's the more fundamental issue, I think, or at least to me.
I don't know which one is more fundamental. So I think it's almost a two-step thing. First of all, if you claim to be a scientific theory, if you claim to be close to data, then you test it, but you can't. Then let's say it's a philosophical theory then, which is maybe okay, right? We talk about philosophical theories sometimes. Usually I like to talk about philosophical theories that are testable, but if you have a philosophical theory that's not testable, okay, we can still talk about it. But yeah, the axioms are mostly false. Mostly, but at least they're not
obviously true.
Many people think some of them are false. Yeah. So today we have two talks. Victor Lama gave a talk about unity of consciousness and basically said, gave a lot of evidence that it's not true, that it's a unique feature of consciousness. And Yale Pinto gave some data about a split brain patient. Again, just flies in the face of those axioms. And there's also one more, Dave Chalmers also came out and talked about how IIT is probably hopeless in solving the meta problem of consciousness. You probably know better than I do what it is. And the argument is if a theory of consciousness does not address the meta problem, it probably will also be hopeless in addressing the hard problem, which is what IIT pretends to be addressing. Right. So I think it's a philosophical theory, it also doesn't cut it. So it's not science. Is bad philosophy, then maybe we just throw it away. I mean, come on. I just don't know why we're so. I think there's some empirical variants of IIT. Some ideas can be taken. I don't mean to throw the baby out of the bathwater. There's some young people. I mean, some junior people doing work on this, like Oyasumi. So there's some good people doing good work related to IIT. Or Adam Barrett himself, I think, does good work. But the fundamental theory is to me should be dead long ago.
Yeah, it is a bit surprising to me that the ideas came with so little data and swept over. And I've seen some really bad philosophizing, around IIT, to be honest. People telling us that it's going to help us understand what it's like to be a bat, for example. And some of the basic philosophical stuff just seems wrong about the theory. The theory can't tell us what it's like to be a bat. I mean, telling us that there's a conceptual structure as defined by IIT doesn't seem to give any kind of hint to what it's like to be the creature with that conceptual structure. I just don't see.
I think it's a pretty broad consensus that the popularity of the theory within philosophy is extremely poor. Almost as poor as its empirical testability. So it's just, to me, I mean, this is okay. In theory, ideas die, nobody's fault. But in my idea, people should try the idea. Sometimes it doesn't work and they should move on and try something else. But to me, it kind of bring out something that to me is quite, quite worrying about the field. Such a bad idea can generate so much heat just out of promotion via the media and one or two senior agenda, which I
definitely think it's been like a 1-2 punch. We got on the one hand Christoph Koch, who threw his weight behind it, but then also Dave Chalmers, who doesn't endorse the theory, but because of his interest in information-based theories of consciousness, he sees this, I think, as a kind of empirical correlates for the other stuff which he believes consciousness is. And so when you have two very influential people saying, well, either this theory is correct or it's got something serious to say about consciousness, then people start to pay attention. And, there are my always kind of complaint is, what about the old everyday workaday cognitive theories out there. So there's global workspace theory, but there's also higher order theories. Of course, I know, you know, as you and I have special interest in those, but it just seems like, so everyone's going to find a certain theory controversial. Like lots of people think higher order theories are just ridiculous. People think IIT is ridiculous. So how do you differentiate between, oh, well, just that's not my theory, so I don't like it, versus no, that's a theory the field really should stop trying to pay attention to?
Yeah, I think there's a difference. I mean, before I address, I mean, I'm saying Dave Chalmers today gave a talk that gave some misgivings about IIT. So maybe even Dave has changed his mind a little bit.
Oh, really?
I think so. He basically said, yeah, Dave Chalmers talked about the meta problem, you know, the meta problem, so why we think there's a problem. And he said that IIT basically is hopeless in addressing the meta problem, and therefore probably also hopeless for, you know, any hopeful theory of consciousness should at least address the meta problem. The hard problem is very hard. But the first step might be to address the meta problem, and IIT is fairly hopeless.
The meta problem being, why do we think there's a problem? Yeah, why do we think there's a hard problem?
Yeah, IIT is just to consciousness not correlated with any function or report or availability or anything. So it's kind of hard to see how we can address the meta problem. At least that's Dave's argument today. And of course, also Giulio himself is also a Tononi, the proponent of the one who proposed the theory, is also a very influential scientist. So we shouldn't just say it's Christoph and Dave. Maybe it's more like Christoph and Giulio. And Dave used to, I'm not sure as of today what it is. But back to the question you asked, like, how do you differentiate? So I think there are theories I don't like that I highly respect, like and they are not cognitive theories, like physicalist theory. So I think like Ned Block and Victor Lama's kind of more first order theory, I think they are serious contenders. And I think we should, if you want to be a physicalist, you want to think some physical substrate is important. That is, if you think there can never be complete strong AI, you want to think that something, you know, brain-based biological substrate that is important.
Yeah, I think that's my opinion.
We should pay attention to Victor and Ned, because they engage with the literature, they have arguments, they bring in data. It's like fully many levels.
So let me just press on you for that for a second, if you don't mind. So why isn't Ned's theory untestable in the same way as IIT?
We talk about it. I think it's not as untestable. I mean,
untestable.
Yeah, IIT is just radically untestable. I just don't even see. I do not see this as science as of today. Yeah,
but you take Ned's view as a scientific theory.
Yeah, I do. Yeah, I think we should, by any standard, consider, you know, Ned's argument based on Victor Lama's lab's data as scientific evidence. Whether they're good evidence, whether you can slice and dice and say, oh, you don't agree how to interpret that's fine. But those I would consider them pretty good direct test and direct evidence. Yeah. So all these paradigms of those post-Q experiments, they're pretty sophisticated, right? When you think about this kind of Sperling type of experiment, I respect that. I don't agree with him, but I can see this is a healthy scientific disagreement that we can have, and we will have to probably make more progress, do more experiments, get more people together, and in, you know, 10 years, if nobody damaged the field like they are doing now, then we'll probably get some consensus from a healthy group of active scientists, and then we call it a day. It's something that's soluble. With IIT, I just don't even see that as part of this exercise.
It's radically untestable.
I think it's radically unscientific.
So do you think that there is a silver bullet, an experiment which can decide between first order theories?
No.
Other theories, or do you think it's going to be accumulation of evidence over a long period of time? Or
yeah, as in cognitive science, neuroscience broadly construed, as in experimental psychology, you know, cognitive psychology, behavioral neuroscience, all of these stuff is like that. There's never any silver bullet. I think that's the fundamental, like kind of a misguided view about consciousness, is that we people think too much of it as physics. It just isn't. I mean, if you want to study consciousness in brains, then you should study brains. You know, you should need to first learn how to study brains.
Yeah, and so I think that's I think you're exactly right, that a lot of people think that there is going to be a kind of silver bullet a key experiment which will differentiate between this view and that view. And you know, like the Sperling is often touted, or you know, even the Schlichte and stuff like that, those kind of experiments which are based on that, the change blindness plus partial report paradigm. There's never going to be one thing which kind of decides the issue. I mean, it seems like at like with most of scientific theories, it's not so much that there's ever something which decides the issue. It's just that there becomes enough evidence that people stop caring about the other alternatives. Yeah. And that's more of how science progresses in these particular cases.
Yes, true. Yeah.
What do you think the best way to study consciousness is? Like, so do you think that contrasting reported seen versus unreported is a good way to study consciousness?
I did that work for most of my adult life. So and in particular, blindsight is a very important paradigm. I think if people understand blindsight, the whole field, the world will be a better place already. I think many people just don't get the point.
Really? So what's the point?
It's just a subjective and objective measures of perception dissociate, which is a point that has been neglected or written off in a high profile paper in 2016 in Nature.
Right. They said if you did it right, then they would be
judiciously. I like the argument, judiciously. So that by that argument, the discovery of patient DF, you know, Miller and Goodale, Weisskranz, all these people are not judicious. That's why they discover all these stuff. All these textbook stuff is not judicious.
If only they had been careful, Hakwan. I mean, come on, then we'd know.
No, but you take that argument. But that argument says subjective and objective measures of perception should be in concordance with each other if they apply judiciously. So, but I think, did I make a logical error there? You can catch me. Like, so by that argument, that must mean that those people who reported dissociation in those classic textbook cases are not judicious.
Yeah, no, exactly.
Yeah. 100%. I find it just frankly ridiculous that anyone can say that in anywhere in print, something like that. But it's sad. So people do miss the point. You see, like, despite all these, you know, decades of classic neuropsychology results, people miss the point. People don't get the subjective and objective measures. Namely, objective meaning, you know, ability to do forced choice tasks. Subjective, namely the subjective reports of phenomenology or confidence or something like that. People don't get that they can dissociate.
So can I ask you just like a personal question about your history? Do I interpret it correctly that when you were young and when you were when you first kind of learned about blindsight, did you think that sort of in your mind was the evidence that is a first evidence for a first order theory? And then you tried to test it and you found prefrontal stuff and that convinced you? Or am I getting that wrong?
Yeah, that part of history is somewhat convoluted. I think when I was an undergrad, I wrote my undergraduate thesis on high order theory. So I always knew what high order theory is. And then when I went about testing it, it wasn't so clear what I was testing. I think back then, that's right. Back then I was more trying to shoot down global workspace theory. I wasn't trying to compare first order and high order. I wasn't so sophisticated to compare theories yet. I was like a graduate student, a young postdoc. And I was just trying to shoot down global workspace. Because by temperament, I'm contrarian. And
but by global workspace theory, really what you had in mind is like frontal involvement, right?
Yeah, I thought that Stan Duane, at that time, global workspace, you know, we talk about circa 2004, 2005. So global workspace was really dominating. It's still dominating. So I was just trying to shoot it down. That's my approach back then. I thought you take the biggest theory and try to find flaws and try to, you know, look for errors in
the fact that I thought it was more than that, though, that you just thought.
So I thought that if you control, if you do the. So go ahead, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought it was a little bit more that I thought that you thought that if people understood blindsight, then they would sort of reject global workspace theory.
Yeah, basically, no, I think it came after. It was experiment first, and then the experiment was the 2006 paper, the PNS paper, which wasn't very good, but the result somehow held up. Or maybe it's not somehow. I mean, if it didn't
wait,
have so it
wait,
up,
wait, wait, wait. You think the 2006 paper is not very good? This is the relative blindsight paper?
Very, very poor.
I mean, and even so, not because of the kinds of criticisms that have come about who you exclude from your study and underpowered studies, not because of those kinds of criticisms, right?
I don't think there's a lot of criticism. No, that's a different one. So you talk about the other the TMS paper.
Yeah.
That paper is just bad because I was a beginner vision scientist. I wasn't in the vision lab. I was in Dick Passingham's lab, who Dick really wasn't very interested in vision, but he gave me the freedom to do that.
Oh, right. I always forget these are two different papers. Right. Okay.
Yeah,
I know that is kind of amazing that he just let you do whatever you want. That's really cool of that guy to do.
Yeah, I'm eternally grateful. And then, but there's a bit of history to that because Larry Weisskranz, who coined the term blindsight, just passed away this year. And there was a bit of history that nobody really, I mean, people told me, but it was not talked about a lot. So Dick Passingham was also a postdoc in Larry Weisskranz's lab. So Larry Weisskranz had a grant on vision, on visual awareness. He was the blindsight guy. And he took on Dick Passingham as a postdoc when Passingham, all he cared about was prefrontal cortex and action. And in some way, it was never told that way, but I think they kind of returned the favor back to the field of visual awareness by having me do a postdoc in his lab doing visual awareness. So there's a bit of twist. So I am Larry's grand student, but it was a bit weird, you know, twist of the story. They were really some of the greatest people, not just in terms of being scientists, they are also great mentors. I think there's a difference between Weisskranz and many other great scientists. It's not just the work he did was great. He left behind a culture of self-critique, of, you know, knowing the literature is almost like a moral duty. It's a very serious culture of how to do behavioral neuroscience.
I mean, I never got to meet him, but yeah, from what you've said, that's, and from what I've heard from other people, that's got to be absolutely right. Yeah.
So I was in Dick's lab, and I did the imaging experiment first, trying to do kind of what we call relative blindsight and normals. So that's basically my whole career. You can sum up as I'm just writing footnotes for Larry. Basically, I'm trying to hope that people get the point of blindsight by doing it in large groups of subjects, of healthy subjects instead of patients. I did test patient a couple of times, but mostly my work is really try to extend that to healthy volunteers, or neurotypical volunteers. And so from there, when I got the result, then I started thinking more about the argument. So the argument is kind of build up from there.
So when you ran the study and you saw that the prefrontal activity survived the manipulations, why weren't you converted to global workspace theory?
Well, because it wasn't so global. It was like there was only a tiny bit that survived. Most of it didn't. A lot of it was gone. And so I thought it wasn't so global. I thought, if anything, the prefrontal involvement isn't to broadcast the signal widely. It didn't look very broad. But I might be wrong. I went back to think about it. I might be wrong. This might be a kind of, there is some fallacy in my reasoning, because with fMRI you really don't know how far the signal has gone, right? So the varietal stuff has kind of gone down, but you don't say. But at least it's not when you match performance between the conditions, the signal is much reduced, and then you also think about it. How does global workspace explain blindsight? And then you start thinking, yeah, it doesn't quite add up. You can have an unconscious signal that is just as strong as a conscious signal. If you titrate, it still match them. It's kind of like, then how does it work? Then you have an unconscious kind of backdoor route that can be so powerful. Then the global workspace isn't so global after all, right? I mean, it's like you're global, but you have another highway that is just as powerful. Then it's more like a dual pathway instead of a global versus local. So I started thinking more about that. And there are other experiments too.
Yeah, that's very interesting, huh? Okay. So do you want to tell us anything about your monkey and magic paper, or is that something we should talk about later?
No, we'll talk about I just gave the paper.
Yeah, I know, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah. What was the question? Sorry,
do you want to tell us about it? So what is it about magic that's got you all excited and
Magic was just a, you know, a bit of a fun way to start to talk and a bit of a intuition pump, which I'm not usually a big fan. You know, I think it's a bit of a dirty trick to do that, but I'm not a real philosopher, so I think I can get away with it. The idea is just that it's just a version of higher order theory to try to think how consciousness is, conscious perception is basically how to think of a way to account for conscious perception is to think of it as there are three features of conscious perception. One is that it has to be, it tends to give you beliefs of the corresponding thing you're seeing. And the beliefs are not just like, you know, some personal things in your representation, they're just personal level beliefs. And it also, the belief seems to be, feel subjectively justified. So there seems to be a logical connection, almost like if you have to justify why you think I'm talking to you now, and you would say, well, because I see you, and that justification. Yeah. So building on that, then you have a certain version of higher order theory. You can account for these features. And these features relate to magic because that also sort of account for some kind of sleight of hand type of magic tricks. Why it's so funny to see, because if conscious perception have those features, then of course, then that's why magic is so fun, because every time you see the magic trick, it indirectly impinge on you a certain belief, and the belief feels right and feels justified, and yet to just violate all the other beliefs you have. So it's like so mind-boggling. But it's not like just like data evidence accumulation, right? Because if you're counting things and you just miscount it and you count it again, then ultimately you're adding the bill in the restaurant and you add it wrong, ultimately you would resolve the issues and just realize, oh, I'm too drunk to add, so let's forget about it. Like you would just at some point you would figure out which premise to take out and the argument would add up. But when it comes to conscious perception, it has this automatic nature that it just every time you see it, it automatically impinge on you that subjectively justified personal level belief. And that's why it's so mind-boggling to see magic. You can see it over and over again, it's still crazy. On top of
your view is that you can't appreciate magic, there can be no unconscious magic.
That's the intuition. That was not a part of the argument. But I think that intuition seems right. I say, like, just show you a magic trick. Like, you see? Yeah, you didn't see it, but it's because it's subliminal. Well, then it's not magic. It's not fun to see. Like, why would you do that? And even if it makes you giggle, it's not quite right to think that it's magic.
So do you think? So that's an interesting point, because if I was wondering about whether if you showed someone a magic trick, but showed it at least, I know you just maybe think that subliminal perception hasn't been demonstrated, although you think maybe it's you know out there. But
it's demonstrated in normal subjects and under masking. I'm not saying that it hasn't been demonstrated.
No, I see. Okay. So suppose you do that, and a person giggles, and then you ask them why, and you say you don't know, then you say they haven't formed the belief on the basis of subliminally processing what happened?
Yeah. So because it's subliminal.
So why do they giggle, though?
Then you think, would it be magic? Like, you do something to people and they giggle. That's not magic. Magic is not making people giggle.
That's true.
They don't think anything, they don't find any the amazement of magic is that it contradicts what they believe. There should be no rabbit here, and suddenly there's a rabbit, and then the rabbit is gone again and back again. It just violates all the expectations you have as a person about the world. That's why magic is magical. It just makes you giggle. That's just like inhaling laughing gas. that's not particularly. That's magical, but different.
How does this get you to the higher order theory?
So if you want to account for these three features, so given the intuition, then you say these three features might be central for conscious perception. Then a certain version of higher, then the argument is not tight. I mean, because there might be other ways to construct a theory that can account for these features. But at least I offer one version. Of a model you can account for them, which is to say you have a higher order representation that points to, which is to index a first order representation and say this representation is a legitimate representation of the world right now. And if you have that kind of representation, you can see how it accounts for all the three things, right? Because, first of all, let's say why do you need to have this higher order tag because, well, your first order representation, that is your visual neurons, fire for different reasons, right? You can fire because you are seeing things. You can fire because it's spontaneous noise, which is huge. You can fire because you are doing, you know, top-down imagination. You can fire because you are hallucinating. You can fire because you are dreaming. You can fire because you are holding something in working memory, for instance. So there are different reasons your visual neurons fire, and I think your brain has to have a way to do this, what we call perceptual reality monitoring, to basically find out the cause of the firing of the sensory neurons. And so when it identifies, okay, these neurons are actually not caused by me, it's not noise, it's triggered by the external world right now. Let's say you have this system, call it a metacognitive system, and that does that. Once it's a subpersonal level process. Once it does that, then of course it's a matter of almost syllogistic inference, because you know that this system is legit because you have lived with that system. This system has been in your brain your whole life. And this system says that representation is legit, and that representation said there's a rabbit out there. So as a matter of, you know, syllogistic inference, logical inference, you can say, well, that therefore, of course, you form the belief that there is a rabbit out there, and that belief is a matter of logical inference. Of course, if you justify,
yeah, so one, take that
every step is like logical.
I was making a Davidson.
Sorry, say again.
I said, take that, Davidson.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So that was, in the same way, it was trying to solve the Donald Davidson puzzle. Donald Davidson has this famous passage that said, like, percepts are not propositional, and only propositions can justify other propositions. So therefore, perceptual beliefs cannot be justified. The relation between percept and belief must be causal, but not logical. But here is a way you can see how it's logical, actually.
It seems like there's almost an in-principle argument here for a higher order theory. And it kind of goes something like this. The brain has to determine whether the signals it's interpreting are signal or noise. Because neurons are always firing, and sometimes they misfire. And so there's got to be some system in the brain which is tuned in to what those things are doing and trying to make the determination about whether it represents things actually out there or some kind of noise or not. And it seems like almost really, that seems to me to be a very difficult thing for a first order theorist to try to account for. Unless they say, well, it's not really monitoring the first order states, but rather somehow trying to get at the content of those states and monitoring what's out there. And that seems like a very difficult claim to make.
Sorry, my wife just chatted me, so I missed the last point. Which claim was difficult?
It's very difficult to differentiate between whether or not what's being monitored are representations of external states, or rather external states. Because that's the difference between higher order and first order theories. So first order theories would like to say that everything is first order, namely that it's representations of things external to
you. I love this prism a lot, but I don't really care so much whether you call it higher order or first order. And I think that's the point, that it's also the same kind of reason why, in the end, David Rosenthal and I also don't think our views are that different. I mean, in the end, it's just how you describe a mechanism, right? So there is a in the end, we want to find a mechanism in the brain that gives rise to or correlates, or let's say gives rise to consciousness. And if this is the mechanism, is a messy neuronal thing. And then how, as a scientist, you try to describe how it works. There are different ways you can describe it. You can call it not a monitor, you can call it a discriminator. I'm not so hung up about whether you call it higher order or something. It is what I describe. If you get it, then you can call it something else, fine. I don't really care. I'm a scientist at the end of the day.
Okay. On that note, I want to thank you for joining us. Do you have anything else you want to add before we sign off?
Great seeing you. Let me see that today. Is any other crazy thing that happened today? Joe LaDue gave a great keynote yesterday. Axel Klerman gave a great keynote. Come to ASSC, it rocks. It's amazing. It's, you know, now that people should really know, if you're interested in consciousness and if you're serious about the empirical studies, come to ASSC. Next one will be in Canada.
Yeah, I completely agree. If you're serious about consciousness, go to the ASSC before you form opinions about the state of the field. Don't go to Tucson. Or if you do, don't form opinions about the state of the field on the basis. Yeah.
Or if you're not serious, then please go to somewhere else and hang out.
I mean, to be fair, I've met some non-serious people at ASSC.
But it's gotten better. So I know what you mean. It's gotten really better over the years. For instance, I said at ASSC, there's still IIT, which I hope it would just go. Because I given my negative opinions about it. I respect the people who do the work, but, you know, good people don't always come up with good ideas. It's just the way science goes. And
yeah, but there is a serious question about, like, smart people throwing away their careers behind things, which maybe not the greatest.
But if they're really smart, they will change their mind soon. I have faith in them. You know, people should not be so stubborn and get married to the theory. That if they do, then they're not that smart after all, right?
Yeah. So, and I would say as a kind of closing remark that there's this look. On the one hand, I don't think you can do consciousness science without theory. Because if you just study the brain but don't have a theory of what the brain's doing, that's useless. On the other hand, if you're over married to theory and you want to just fit all the data to the theory, then that's also very bad as well. So I think it's important to recognize that we do need theories in order to make sense of what's going on. But we want to be open to the idea that we don't know which is the right theory, and we don't want to pluck one out and be like, I'm going to devote my life to that one. We should be open to the data guiding our choice about theories. But theories are still very important to understanding what's going on.
It's a good note to end on. Balance. Good seeing you.
Good seeing you too. Don't sign off yet. I'll talk to you just for a second afterwards.
All right, good.
All right. Yeah.